Aggregation is a very important part of, you know, the whole farming process. So you have these smallholder farmers everywhere, but a smallholder farmer cannot rent a vehicle to carry his produce from the farm to the market. So we have an aggregation point. Each of the service centers is also an aggregation point. So they take their products, the product can be taken to the aggregation point. And it is from the aggregation point that they are paid. It is from the aggregation point that if they have loans, loans are deducted from what they are paid. And then their goods are then sent, their produce is then sent to markets from that point. 109 of these service centers will be located in the 109 senatorial districts of Nigeria, and they'll be called process service centers. But in addition, the process service centers will be able to serve as throughput from which we can add some value to agricultural products, especially those that are brought in by the local farmers. So service centers will be based on the comparative and complementary advantage that each location has, and along, you know, existing value chains. So for now, the value chains that we'll be servicing using these service chains will be grains, cereal, livestock, poultry, fruits, roots and tubers, some horticulture also. And, you know, and we hope that we'll be able, especially livestock and poultry, we hope we'll be able to do quite a bit of that. So for us, the green imperative, as we've called it, is the next level for Nigerian agriculture. But we're still very far from our targets for self-sufficiency in food production. Because this, I mean, the fact that there's such a huge gap between what we hope and where we are, it means that there is tremendous opportunity for investments. But even more exciting are the prospects for export. Because when you look at the opportunities today, they are simply mind-boggling. The story of investors in agriculture in Nigeria is really worth hearing. There's a Mexican farmer, his name is Carlos, and he is the proprietor of farms called San Carlos Farms, possibly the largest farmer of vegetables, bananas, pineapples in Mexico, but he's invested in Nigeria in several different locations. A lot of those who invited him to partner with them wanted him to grow vegetables, grow bananas and pineapples, and then export, you know, because this was what he did so successfully in Mexico. The idea was, of course, to grow this, but what happened, he now has about, I think, about 5,000 hectares of farms in about six states, then he's taken another 10,000 hectares. After his first harvest, he exported nothing at all, but he was able to give all his investors a very decent profit. And his partners asked him what the magic was. His answer was, we can't even satisfy the local demand. The local demand is so high that we can't satisfy it. So what's the point of exporting? You can't even deal with local demand. And he was selling locally at the equivalent of $3 per kg. And in Europe, you would have been selling for $1 per kg. So he was doing much better locally. And which is really the point. You know, there's so much opportunity because we have a huge market. Everybody has been talking of the African Free Trade Continental Zone. Why will Nigeria sign? Where will Nigeria sign? Why is everybody interested in Nigeria signing? Because we are the market. We are the big market. Where else is a market as large as ours in Africa? So everybody wants to do business here. Everybody wants to export something here if they can. But we have a huge market, and we need to take advantage of that market. Even if we are selling to ourselves alone, there's so much room for prosperity. We still have a substantial percentage of the world's arable land. We are the ninth largest in terms of available arable land in the world today. We are the ninth largest. And most of that land, we haven't even cultivated it anyway. So it's becoming clearer that the whole world itself is looking to Africa, and Nigeria in particular, as its food basket. Just to take China's demand alone, the demand that China has been making on, you know, so many different things that we produce. China has 27% of the world's population, but it has only 7% of the world's arable land for agriculture. So it needs 2 million tons of hybrid soya beans per annum for livestock and feed and vegetable oil We cannot even meet that demand. We are not even close to meeting it. Sesame seed, it needs about 2 million tons per annum. China needs 2 million tons per annum. That's the demand from China, from Vietnam, from Japan, and you know, and some of the Arab countries. But we can't even meet that. They need it for sesame seed oil. They need it for cake and confectionaries. But we're not even close to it. China also requires 2.3 million tons of cassava chips and cassava products for industrial starch and ethanol. We don't even, with all of our production, we're not even coming close because we're not processing. We're not processing the kind of quantity that they need. Africa, the whole of Africa, has not been able to meet China's total demand for cocoa. For cocoa, we have not been able, the whole of Africa, not just Nigeria. So the demand is huge. How about goat meat? Goat meat. How about goat meat? 120,000 carcasses of goat meat is required every week in several Arab countries. 120,000 carcasses. We don't even have that. We're still, you know, in Lagos, I think we do about 10,000 cows. I think it's about 10,000 cows that we do in Lagos. We simply don't have, you know, the required output, and there's so much that's waiting. Most of Vietnam's demand for over 2.5 million tons of cashew is unmet. All of the cashew that we produce, everything we export, we send to Vietnam, and it doesn't even scratch the surface because they still need 2.5 million tons, you know. So Nigeria's role as a food provider to the world, and especially in the next few decades, is very clear. There's no question at all that if we focus on production of food, if we focus on production of food locally, and focus on it even for export, the sky really, as I say, is the limit. In the next few years, Nigeria will be self-sufficient in most of its food requirements. And I believe we'll be net exporters of several different foods as well. We'll be net exporters if we keep our focus. Of course, there are many, many challenges. You know, the conflicts in the Northeast, Northwest, you know, farmer herder clashes and all of those things are the challenges. But they are challenges. And challenges, of course, are meant to be dealt with, they're meant to be resolved. And we will, by the grace of God, resolve a lot of those challenges. So with better inputs today and better farming methods, this will greatly aid our leapfrogging. We are at the best time in history, the very best time in history. Technology is on our side. All of the new inputs that increase acreage, increase yield, everything is available today. There's no time that is better than this time in the history of the world for achieving all of our own objectives as a nation and as a people. And I pray that the Almighty God will help us to achieve everything that we want to achieve. Thank you very much.